Hello students, with the increase in the number of coronavirus cases in the world, I hope you all are taking precautionary measures such as washing your hands frequently with soap, covering your mouth while sneezing, and most importantly, maintaining social distances to keep yourself and your family safe. Moving further, first of all, I would like to thank you for watching the previous video where I discussed briefly about sexual and asexual reproduction. Today, I will be explaining the chapter Sexual Reproduction in Flowering Plants. First of all, what is the biological term for flowering plants? It is angiosperms. And if I say sexual reproduction, that means there is a male and a female reproductive organ in the plant. Now, what is the male reproductive organ referred to as? It is the androecium, which is made up of stamens. And the female reproductive organ is the gynoecium, which is made up of pistil. So today, in this video, I'll be explaining in detail the structure of stamen and the formation of the male gametophyte, that is the pollen grain, the structure of pistil and the formation of female gametophyte, that is the embryo sac. Now, let us discuss the structure of a flower. As you have studied earlier, a flower has four molds, that is calyx, which is represented by sepals, corolla, which is represented by petals, androecium, which comprises of stamens, and gynoecium, which is made up of pistils. Now, this flower, it could be unisexual or bisexual. Unisexual flower could be pistillate, that means it has only the female reproductive organ, or it could be staminate, that it could have only the stamens, the male reproductive organ, or it could be bisexual. Now, as you can see here, the stamens are made up of filament and anther, and here you can see the pistil, which comprises of ovary, style and stigma. In this chapter, we are going to discuss in detail about the male reproductive organ, that is the stamen first, followed by the female reproductive organ, that is the pistil. Now, let us see the structure of a stamen. A stamen comprises of two parts, filament and anther. Now, this is what you studied in your earlier class, but now, we are going to go in detail and study in depth the structure of the anther and how the pollen grain is produced. As you can see, the anther is bilobed. It has two lobes and each lobe is dithecous. That means each lobe has two compartments. Now, each lobe has two microsporangia, which are enclosures that develop into pollen sac in which the microspores are formed. So in total, we have four microsporangia. Now, let's study the structure of microsporangium in detail. As you can see here, the microsporangia has four walls. The outer three are for protection and for the dehiscence of anther. The outermost wall is known as the epidermis. Inner to it you have the endothecium, then the middle layers, and innermost layer is the tapetum. So the main function of outer three walls is the protection, and the function of tapetum is the nourishment of the developing pollen grains. Now, this is the picture of a very young anther. They have inner to the wall layers, you can see the sporogenous tissue. Now, this tissue is a group of homogeneous diploid cells. And each cell is a microspore mother cell or a pollen mother cell, and it is diploid. Now, this microspore mother cell or pollen mother cell
undergoes meiosis to form a microspore tetrad. Now, as the name indicates, tetrad means a cluster of four microspores. And this process of formation of microspore from the microspore mother cell through meiosis is known as microsporogenesis. So, just to recap, the sporogenous tissue which is present in the center of each microsporangium, the cell in the sporogenous tissue is a pollen mother cell, or you can also call it microspore mother cell. It undergoes meiosis to form microspore tetrad. When the antithesis, each microspore matures to form a pollen grain. Now, this pollen grain is known as the male gametophyte. Now, why it is known as gametophyte? Because it produces the male gametes. In this slide, we will see how the microspore tetrad dissociates. It forms the single microspore, as you can see here, and it matures to form the pollen grain. Now, this microspore tetrad undergoes mitosis. In this figure, you can see the asymmetric spindle. Whenever the asymmetric spindle is formed, it results in the formation of two unequal daughter cells, and that is what is happening here in the pollen. There are two unequal daughter cells. The larger is the vegetative cell and the smaller one is the generative cell. Now, this vegetative cell, as you can see, it is larger in size, it has abundant food reserve and irregular shaped nucleus. The generative cell is smaller. It floats in the cytoplasm of this vegetative cell. It is spindle shaped and it has a dense cytoplasm and nucleus. Now, discussing further about the structure of the pollen grain, it has two wall layers. The outer wall layer is known as exyne and the inner wall layer is known as intyne. There's an interesting feature about this exyne. It is made up of sporopollenin, and this sporopollenin is the one of the most organic, most resistant organic material known. You know, it is resistant to the action of acids, alkali, enzymes. It is resistant to high temperature. It cannot be degraded by any of these. And that is a reason it has been preserved as a fossil. In the exyne, you will also find an aperture or an opening, you can say as minute opening, known as germ pore. And this germ pore serves as an entry for the pollen tube. Now, most of the times this pollen grain is released at this two-celled stage. But in some cases, the generative cell, it divides by mitosis to form two male gametes, and the pollen grain is released at the three-celled stage. Now, one thing more I would like to discuss about the pollen grains is the pollen allergies. Pollen allergies are usually associated with grasses, and one common example is the Parthenium grass, also known as carrot grass, which was initially imported with the wheat. And this Parthenium grass is a weed. Now, weed is that unwanted grass. And you know, this Parthenium grass, it produces 3000 million pollen grains per square meter during the flowering season. And it can cause asthma, puffy eyes, eczema, runny nose. So, pollens are usually associated with allergies. But the pollen are also highly nutritious. And these days, pollen tablets are available in the market. One common pollen tablet is the bee pollen, and it is rich in vitamins, minerals and antioxidants, and these serve to decrease the inflammation and improve the immunity. You know, these pollen tablets are also used for increasing the athlete's performance and the performance of race horses. Now, these pollens can also be used in the future crop development programs. How can they be used? Because they can be preserved in liquid nitrogen at minus 196 degrees centigrade. Just like we have the seed banks, we have the sperm banks. Similarly, we also have pollen banks where this pollen can be served at this extremely, they can be stored at the extremely low temperature and can be used for the future crop improvement programs. So that was all about the formation of pollen grain. And now next we come to the female reproductive organ, that is the gynecium. Gynecium, as I told you, is made up of pistils. If the gynecium is made up of one pistil, it is known as monocapillary, for example mango. And if it is made up of more than one pistil, it is known as multicarpillary, for example lotus. Now, in case there are more than one pistil, it is multicarpillary. All the pistils could be fused, and in this case they are referred to syncarpous, or the pistils in multicarpillary ovary, they could be free and they are referred to as apocarpous. Now, in this figure you can see the structure of a pistil, which comprises of the basal swollen part known as ovary. This is the extension known as style, and to which is attached the stigma, that is the landing platform for the pollen grains. This ovary, as you can see here, it has a cavity in which the ovules are present, and these ovules are attached with the help of placenta. Now, in the next slide, we are going to discuss the structure of the ovule in detail. So please pay attention. Now, this is the structure of an anatropous ovule. Anatropous means an inverted ovule, which is inverted at 180 degrees. And sometimes you get this question of 2 marks, draw the structure of an anatropous ovule. So don't get confused, you just have to draw this diagram. Now, in this figure you can see that the outer protective covering, it is known as integuments, and we have 2 integuments here which serve to protect the ovule, the outer integument and the inner integument. Now, how is this ovule attached to the placenta? It is attached with the help of a small stalk known as funicle, and the place where this ovule attaches or fuses with the funicle is known as hilum. Within the integuments you have this tissue which is known as mucilus, and it has the food reserves. And within the mucilus is the main part, that is the embryo sac, which is the female gametophyte. Now, I am calling it the female gametophyte. Why? Because it produces the female gamete. And what is the female gamete? It is the egg. This end is called the micropylar end because this is the place where the pollen tube enters, and opposite to it is the chalazal pole. Now, we are going to discuss a very important part, that is the development of the embryo sac. Now, one of the cells in the micropylar end of the nucellus differentiate into megaspore mother cell. So, as you can see here, the micropylar end of the nucellus, one cell differentiates into megaspore mother cell. Now, this megaspore mother cell undergoes the first meiotic division to form 2 megaspores, and the next meiotic division to form a megaspore tetrad, that is a group of 4 megaspores. Out of these 4 megaspores, 3 will degenerate and only 1 will remain. This process of formation of 1 megaspore from the megaspore mother cell is known as megasporogenesis. I discussed previously also, genesis means formation. So, as the name indicates, megasporogenesis, the formation of a megaspore. So, if you are asked what is megasporogenesis, it is the formation of one megaspore from the megaspore mother cell. Here you can see this is a single megaspore. So, the megaspore undergoes mitotic division to form two nuclei. Then it undergoes a second mitotic division to form four nuclei. A third mitotic division to form eight nuclei. So, it has undergone three mitotic division. In the first mitotic division, the nuclei move to opposite poles. Then it undergoes two sequential mitotic divisions, resulting in the formation of four and eight nuclei. Once the eight nuclei are formed, the cell walls are laid down. The cell walls are laid down in such a way that we have three cells at the micropylar end, and it is known as the egg apparatus. It comprises of egg and two synergids. We have three cells at the chalazal end, which are referred to as antipodals, and two cells at the center, which are referred to as two polar nuclei. So finally, we have the eight nucleate, seven cell structure, as you can see here. The antipodals are at the chalazal end. At the micropylar end, you have one egg cell, two synergids. You can also see here finger-like projections known as filiform apparatus, and this helps in the entry of the pollen tube, which reaches the egg cell and finally releases the male gamete for the fusion. In the center, you can see the polar nuclei, and the cell at the center is known as the central cell. So what do you see here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 nuclei. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 cell. So this is known as 8 nucleate, 7 cell embryo sac. Now, you will come across a term known as monosporic development. Again, as I told you, the answer lies in the question. What is monosporic development? So that is development of a monospore. As you can see here, this is a megaspore which develops into the embryo sac. So the formation of embryo sac from a single megaspore is known as monosporic development. Now let's have a quick recap. A single megaspore mother cell gets differentiated at the micropylar end of the nucellus. It undergoes meiosis to form four megaspores, out of which three degenerate and one megaspore is functional. The first mitotic division, the nuclei move to opposite direction. Then the second and third mitotic division lead to the formation of eight nuclei. It is followed by laying down of cell walls, and finally we have the eight nucleate, seven cell embryo sac. The three cells you can find at the micropylar end comprise the egg apparatus. Three cells at the chalazal end comprise the antipodals, and there are two polar nuclei in the central cell. So this was all about the formation of the male gametophyte, that is pollen grain, and the female gametophyte, embryo sac. So please go through this video carefully, and I'll be back in the next video with the remaining part of the chapter. Thank you. God bless. Stay safe.